through the carbonate, that's how I got free. Jabba back off because there's no stopping me. Postmodern player, sample-tastic, flows ekphrastic, I get drastic. Hey, watch the plastic, yo, I name check and leave.
Welcome to the MacGuffin, episode 224. I'm Spencer.
I'm Greg.
Today, in honor of the release of Parker, we're going to be talking Jason Statham.
American, wait, English badass.
Yes.
Yes.
I can't keep this voice up too long. So,
going to get back to normal speaking because that's just too difficult. And
yes.
It probably sounds terrible to all those nice folks
to
watching
everybody.
Us. Yes.
Including each other.
Jason Statham, an interesting dude. As you left in our cliffhanger last time, you said you're not a big fan of him. I'm looking forward to hearing some of those reasons.
Less not a big fan of him, more not a big fan of any of his movie choices.
I can respect that. There are some people like I have issues with that as well. First up, I want to note, you know, despite Jason Statham being a pretty popular dude, he's never been nominated for any award, according to IMDb.
Yes.
His films have been nominated for some...
variety of weird up and downs.
Yeah, but specifically him, nothing, which is kind of amazing.
But I'm
kind
of not surprised.
He's not a bad actor. Like, there's got to be something. Like,
I know, but they don't give, like, best action star awards. They do in, like, MTV awards and crap like that. But in that case, why would Statham be the top of that pile?
Why has he even gotten a Razzie Award or nomination? Like, he's never even been nominated. I'm not saying he has to win, but a nomination? He's not a bad...
I bet In the Name of the King got it one. Really?
No, nothing. Like, that's just the thing. That's what I'm saying.
So you're riding that middle line, Jason, all the way to the bank.
Okay. Maybe the film did, but he specifically for that film?
Fine.
No. Like, it's unbelievable. Like, a nomination.
And it's like his first,
I'll give him a MacGuffin nomination for something. Like, Transporter was
gravelly fun. Voice.
Yeah. Worst film selection in Crank. Like, I don't know. I'm in that minority. I don't know. We'll see. But let's start towards the beginning and
talk about the actual beginning.
Yes. Of time. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels.
His film debut, which is what I was insinuating at the beginning. Spencer,
so clever. Obviously, this is directed by Guy Ritchie, you know, his sort of breakout creation about, four London working class stiffs pool their money to put in one high-stakes card game, but things go wrong and they end up owing £500,000 and having 1 week to come
up. A very scary mobster.
Yeah.
Bricktop.
Yeah.
Great guy. Great villain.
It's kind of funny to think about this film, because this film had a bunch of sort of people popping. I mean, you had Vinnie Jones popping out. You had Jason...
Bricktop's the other movie. Sorry, I'm thinking Hatchet Harry.
Yeah. Jason Statham. You had other people like Jason Fleming and Dexter Fletcher. A whole bunch of people sort
of... Sting in it. Sting plays his dad.
That doesn't hurt. Never hurts. And, of course, Guy Ritchie and Matthew Vaughn coming...
Yeah.
Popping out, both of them, who've gone on to do big
things. Many big things.
In terms of, I guess, I don't know what you want to talk about, Jason Statham's career and Guy Ritchie's career, where do you kind of look at this film?
This is probably one of my favorites of both of those. I mean, I feel like it's a kind of a 1-2 punch of this and Snatch. I feel they both have their varying strengths, and not that I feel one is necessarily better than the other, but I think specifically more in Snatch, Jason Statham gets a bit more chance to be front and center and shine, but I really enjoy his character in this. In Lockstock, specifically because it's actually what he did. Like, that's where Guy Ritchie found him on the street hawking fake jewelry and all that stuff, and that's how he got hired.
I mean, I sort of agree with you. I definitely tend to prefer Guy Ritchie's earlier stuff. This, Snatch, and even to a certain degree, Rock and Rolla.
Yeah.
More sort of original, sort of more organic creations of his instead of, Sherlock Holmes is fine.
Yeah.
But, it's
and then
really.
It's like, swept away.
I mean.
And then, of course.
You're married to Madonna.
And then
Revolver
is like taking all those ideas of trying to be complicated and just going too far.
Yeah. But, the thing about Jason Statham is. Yeah, he's a badass. He's a very good action star, but there's also two things about him. He's pretty charming.
Yes.
Very likable dude in a lot of his film roles, even though he plays what could be despicable guys. And he's pretty funny.
Yeah,
like, he's
definitely.
Got very good comedic timing. And,
which is why it's sad that he hasn't been in as many comedic roles as she probably should be.
Yeah.
At least intentional comedic roles. Many of these ones coming up are comedic on accident.
That's true. But, you know, I think, I don't know if you could say, maybe with the exception of perhaps the action-y type stuff, like I feel like Guy Ritchie's been very good about sort of highlighting the actual good dramatic sort of acting side of him and the comedy
angle. I would agree
with that. He's very good at playing those angles up. Not so much like, you know, badass transporter type stuff, but it's, I mean, it's still a very enjoyable film.
Oh yeah, I love this film.
I mean, it's no surprise that it won the audience award at the BAFTAs, which is pretty sweet.
Nice.
I mean, Guy Ritchie and Matthew Vaughn were nominated for Best British Film. You know, it won an Empire Award for Best British Film, and it won Best Debut for Vinnie Jones.
Wow, yeah.
Did pretty well this as well. So.
I think the day they started shooting this, Vinnie Jones had just been released from jail.
Seems about right.
He gets arrested a lot.
Seems about right.
Vinnie Jones, the only soccer player, I think, to ever be ejected from a game for biting his own teammate. Not an opposing teammate, his own teammate.
I gotta say, though, I mean, I would say Jason Statham is very similar to Vinnie Jones in a lot of ways, except probably a little bit more action-oriented, but both of them are very good comedic performers, and both very good sort of dramatic performers, too. They're both underrated, I mean, you know.
I remember owning this movie on VHS.
What?
Boom. In the 90s.
In the 90s.
One of my last VHS I bought, it had a weird, like, pop-out, like, desk thing that came with the VHS tape.
Very cool.
Very strange.
Cool. Probably one of the most signature roles of his career, if not the most signature, is The Transporter.
Yes.
This is the Luc Besson series directed by Louis Leterrier, who went on to do, you know, Transport 2, Unleashed, The Incredible Hulk, and one of Greg's favorite movies, Clash of the Titans remake.
Yeah. The Sam shit in my face Worthington.
I personally think, and granted, I don't have as much investment in the original, but I think the first one in the series is kind of overhated upon, but the second one, man, like when they had a chance for redemption, I don't know how
and
you
fucked that
up.
And they failed it.
I don't know how you fucked that up. Obviously, Jason Statham is the titular character in this as a man.
As he is in many of his films.
Yes. Well, now he is.
They have a the.
Yeah. but he plays a getaway driver, not unlike Driver.
Correct.
Drive. Who essentially has a very strict set of rules in terms of what he'll help out. You know, don't want to know what's the package.
Yeah, exactly.
Just tell me where it
went. Delivers a package, no questions asked type of thing.
And obviously, the rules have to be broken when it turns out he's transporting a woman.
Yep. An alive woman, not like just a body.
And of course, you know, the people who have him transporting aren't too pleased with this change.
And shenanigans occur.
Yeah. And badass action scenery occur. Mm-hmm. I don't know. What do you think about this movie?
This movie is...
And the series, I guess.
The whole series is ridiculous. But it's ridiculous in a way that, first off, Jason Statham seems to have made his bread and butter. And B, is kind of always been hinted at Luc Besson's action. It's always been right on that border of being really, really cool, but almost silly, or really silly and almost cool. Like, I feel like he rides that line back and forth.
I think for the most
with
part,
action.
This series... It rides the line, with the exception of the second film where they flip the car over and he like blows off the bomb. Like that's a little bit much, but for the most part, I think the action is pretty much solid. It's usually my problem is the stories feel so lightly thread in there that it's just sort of like, okay, you know, it's just an excuse for Jason Statham to beat up some people and then throw in Francois Berléand. For some comedic relief.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he's great as Inspector, was it Tarkani? It was very funny, but it's just sort of like, it feels very threadbare in terms of actual storytelling.
You know, the story is usually not as important in a lot of the classic action movies, so I think this was kind of just going along that similar vein. However, it is interesting to note, regardless of what I actually feel about the series, this starts a long line of Jason Statham doing most of his own stunts.
Yeah,
he substantially
he's good about that.
Stays
yeah,
into
good.
Doing his stunts, as we'll bring up as we move along. Also, it's interesting because you're talking about unrealisticness in the Transporter series. The trailer for this film originally showed Jason Statham's character Frank deflecting a missile with a tea tray. And in the same scene in the film, the salt, in the actual released version, that doesn't happen. And that was because Jason Statham requested it be taken out because he didn't think that the audience would believe it. That was his defining line.
That's smart.
I mean, it is. Too bad it didn't carry over to the...
Well, to be fair, like, is it anything that you haven't seen, like, say, Skyfall when he drives the car into the train? Yeah, I mean, that's essentially more or less the same sort of thing. Like, let's be real. It's just essentially, like, another James Bondy type character but with less story.
Less story and almost no backup. Not a whole entire government or agency backing him up. Which is problematic when you have lone dude who can do everything on his own forever.
I mean, I would, I would say he's... I don't know. I guess they're both pretty serious guys. I would say... They're both pretty charming characters, him and Bond.
Oh, definitely.
Like, both of them have their sort of way about themselves. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it's... Obviously, the series has felt, like, even less threadbare as the series goes on in terms of storytelling. Mm-hmm. But, you know, in terms of, like, action, like, he's very solid in him. And he's good at doing his own stunts. I respect him for it.
So. I gotta give him a lot of credit for that. And that's at least one of the things he can do well.
Yeah. Yeah. Moving right along, probably one of the, I would say, more interesting films he's done, The Italian Job.
Yes.
This is a remake directed by F. Gary Gray, who did a whole bunch of amazing stuff, if you actually think about it. He did Friday, the original Friday.
Nice.
He did Set It Off
with
Queen Latifah
and
Jada Pinkett.
Bank robber movie.
Yeah, it's actually a fairly entertaining one. The Negotiator, very solid one. Samuel L. Jackson, Kevin Spacey.
Yep.
A Man Apart, the Vin Diesel film where his wife is killed and he sort of goes on a hunt for the drug dealer.
Hair.
Yeah, you know, it's not a great film, but you know, I like the concept of it. I just wish it had been better.
Yeah.
And sadly, after that, it's a little bit mixed with Be Cool, which was the Get Shorty sequel.
That's
and
right.
He did Law Abiding Citizen, which was actually a fairly entertaining film.
That's
not
the,
great.
Is that Gerard Butler?
Gerard Butler and Jamie Foxx, where
that's
he plays the man whose wife is killed, and so he wants
that's
to get.
Right.
Payback on the like the judge and all those people
from behind bars.
Well, no, he's actually out, but
that's
then
right.
he doesn't. They arrest him. He openly admits it, and then he sort of flaunts it by saying like, "You can put me behind bars. I'm still going to kill these people," and he essentially does, which is pretty awesome. But in terms of The Italian Job, you know, a lot of people who really liked the original film before this came out and were really skeptical of this movie. The cast is phenomenal.
And
I
mean, it's actually a pretty good remake.
Yeah.
I mean, they pay tribute to the original and everything.
But you think about, like, the cast in this. I mean, you got Wahlberg, Charlize Theron, Donald Sutherland, Statham, Seth Green, Mos Def, a.k.a. Yasin Bey, and Edward Norton, who was there reluctantly after he signed that...
A three-picture deal.
Yeah, to be in, was it...
It was with Paramount, but I think Primal Fear was
Primal Fear, That's the one he wanted to be in, so he agreed to be in 300 films. This,
I believe, was the last film debut, too.
Yeah. But anyway, you know, very skeptical about the remake, a lot of people were. I think, you know, the thing about this was that they picked such a charming cast, and they did such a good job of keeping it entertaining that it made... people sort of come around.
I would agree.
I mean, it was a very enjoyable
film. Rather than trying to, like, update it in the sense of, like, super explosions and all the cars go 800 times faster and everything's zanier, they just elaborated the heist a bit, updated things, but then still made, like, very lovable, likable characters that work together as a team.
And they're definitely some sort of nods to the original. Like, I mean, they had a Mini Cooper chase, though they were the new Mini Cooper,
and
the
debut. Mini Cooper that Charlize Theron first drives in the movie is directly an homage to the original Mini Coopers from the original film, so.
And that's not even to say that that's necessarily the most successful elements of the film. Like, apparently, you know, and this is something that recurs through almost all the films from now on that we're going to talk about. The film got won a World Stunt Award for the high speed boat chase through the canals of Venice in the beginning of the film. So, you know, whether that's a memorable scene to people or not, it was a very
complicated
cool scene as
stunt,
well.
At least.
So, I mean, it's just a very solid film. I would say, in terms of Jason Statham specifically, he
Handsome
kind of.
Rob.
He's good. He's very funny. He's very good.
He's much more supporting in this than
Yes, I would say him, Seth Green, and Mos Def are all sort of stuck in a sort of comedic supporting category. And this is really a Mark Wahlberg, Charlize Theron, and Edward Norton film.
But I think it's interesting going along that line of, like, Statham, again, regardless of my opinion of him, like, him being in movies where there's a lot of dedication to things. In interviews, he said that in addition to the stunt driving course that all the cast received, they got a two-day driving tuition from Damon Hill, British ex-world champion Formula One driver. And then they said, however, they all agreed that out of the whole cast, Charlize Theron was easily the best driver among them.
I mean, that's just shitty. I mean, she just won an Academy Award. She's a model.
She also got 2 speeding tickets during the filming of this because she said after filming such fast driving scenes, it was impossible for her to slow down on
like,
the way home.
What is not great in her life? She's got a kid. I know. She's pretty much living the dream.
I know.
So screw you, Charlize, I guess. Is
seriously. You can make stinkers like Aeon Flux and then still bounce back with, the, you know, like young adult and monster. I mean, gosh, everywhere.
Yeah, she's not doing too bad for herself. Mm-mm. But you know, I guess this is much more sort of towards the lock stock side of the spectrum, where he's much more sort of charming, comedic.
I wish he would do more of.
Yeah, probably.
But I'm glad he at least did this.
Yeah.
However.
Yeah. However,
things go the other direction, more Transporter-esque.
This is a couple years later.
Yeah.
2006. I would say this is. I mean, I've seen only bits of Dungeon Siege, in The Name of the King. So I can't necessarily say this is definitively the worst film he's done, but for me, this is the most... let's check that. The sequel to this is the worst film, and that's Crank.
Yes.
Directed by Neville Dean and Taylor, who I think, personally, are arguably some of the most obnoxious filmmakers I've ever seen. After having watched this, I did watch Crank 2. It was on streaming, so I watched it.
More cranked? Crankier?
Crank 2 High Voltage, I believe it's called.
That's right, yes.
And it was even worse than this film, so that was something. And then I tried to watch another one of their films, Gamer, which is sort of people being controlled in a video game.
That's the same people?
It's same people. I couldn't even finish watching it. It was virtually unwatchable. Like, you think this is like a shaky handy cam sort of style? Like, that thing is like literally like, I went through Cloverfield and I was like, this is a great film. I enjoyed that. And like Gamer, I was like, okay, I need like motion sickness. This is
not accounting for motion sickness, but just for Terra bad stature.
It's bad.
I will say that Dungeon Siege is really awful.
Okay.
It's really awful. Okay. Like, put it on, leave the room, come back, want to turn it off even though you've missed things because you can't sit there.
But at least you can physically watch
it. It's an Uwe Boll movie, too.
Right, but you can physically watch it. Like, Gamer, I couldn't even finish. I couldn't even, I was like, I'm getting sick here. And I don't even really get, like, I mean, as I said, I made through Cloverfield, no problems. Like, I mean, Crank is very much the same sort of shaky camera.
And it's such a... sorry if you like it. It's a contrived, stupid idea.
No, check this. I will say that I like the concept of a man who's sort of put in a position of... He's on the verge of death, and he has to essentially keep himself alive.
It's like one man speed. That's what it is.
Yeah.
One man speed.
Except he would literally... I would say that's essentially it. It's like Speed, but with one man. And, you know... Like, it's sort of like, you know, we talked about Dracula. Mm-hmm. Like, why would anyone want to do this? But you're like, okay, you know, Francis Ford Coppola, Bram Stoker, blah, blah,
sounds
blah.
Sounds good on paper.
Yeah, I mean, you got Jason Statham.
You're like, oh, guy from Transporter. We can get him in another action
He's role. A very charming guy. You know, you got a sort of Speed-like plot, which I actually don't mind. You might not. But
I know I'm in the minority of speed hating.
You know, those two things are not necessarily bad. You have some decent supporting characters. Amy Smart, I generally enjoy... Efren Ramirez was good as Pedro. Dwight Yoakam has been interesting and stuff, you know.
He has some strange roles, but they're usually pretty good.
Yeah, you know. And the problem is nobody's good in this film. Like, honestly, like, the best part of this movie was the cameo by Glenn Howerton as the sort of medical assistant.
Dennis from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
As just, like, a guy in the hospital who is just, like, a nurse
or
something.
That's how you know your movie is bad, when your action movie's best part is a cameo, not by another action star, which will come.
Yeah. It's just, the thing is...
Yeah.
I can't even really explain. Like, the action in this movie, you talk about Transporter being contrived.
Yes.
The action is so over the top and manic that it's not even enjoyable.
No.
They throw in scenes like him having
sex.
Just like, I get what they're trying to say, like, you need to get his heart racing or something like that, but it just feels so egregious and obnoxious that it's not entertaining. And then they do it even more egregiously in the second one. They do it in the middle of a horse track during a race with Amy Smart as well. Like, I don't know how bad her career has gone that she had to, like, sign up for this. But probably the best thing in the movie is, honestly, Glenn Howerton or Dwight Yoakam. He's kind of nice as the, like, fucked up doctor who's, like, doing coke and shit. Like, it's just, you don't, like...
Jason Statham did all his own stunts.
That's cool.
One positive.
But the problem is, like, and I've said this in other projects before, that, like, when there are no likable characters, I find I have a lot of trouble watching it because I just don't care about anything.
Yeah.
And this just is not only not visually interesting, but it's nobody's likable, and so it's like a double whammy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much Neville Dean and Taylor's career in that show, because the things we mentioned thus far are all bad. Plus, they did Ghost Rider 2, which was the one where he peed fire. Like, oh my god! Like, in 3D, no less. So, like, honestly, I don't know why these people keep getting.
Because there's enough stupid people that think that Crank would be awesome, so they saw it in the theaters and it made enough money.
It did
to make
money.
A sequel,
and it won a World Stunt Award for the scene where he drives the motorcycle and stands up and then flies into like the cafe when it crashes. Like, it's just, it is if.
I feel like Crank or these guys' movies are literally like 13-year-old.
Yes, that's a perfect description. It's literally like you gave a 13-year-old like $20 million, and like make a movie, and they're like, okay.
And they had enough people around to at least kind of do it for them, and then they were just like, yeah, but like, Suze Garry's got to get up, so like, let's have him have sex in public. And isn't the second one where he puts the car battery thing on his tongue, or something?
Yeah, I think that's the second one.
It's like the cover of the second. But
also, the second one, like, he sticks like a shotgun up a dude's ass and like blows him away or something. Like,
classy, it's, Statham. It's just, like, way to class it up.
I don't blame him. I don't know why. I guess on paper you could kind of see why he would want to do it, but like, why you'd come back for the second one, that boggles my mind.
Yeah,
and. It's funny, because, like, I'll even say that the next one we're going to talk about, Death Race, is much better than that.
Sadly, yes.
Like, it is. Death Race is not a good movie.
No.
It's not. But again, this is sort of one of those films that, like, I kind of get where you're wanting to do it. It's kind of like a throwback to a classic film, you know?
It's originally supposed to be a prequel to Death Race 2000.
Yeah.
And I think, like... I think Corman produced it, actually.
I'm sure.
So he was involved with it. So, yeah. I mean, it's like a semi-official... thing, but it's like, what's the director?
Paul W.
Yeah, Paul W. S. Anderson had the rights for this movie for like 13 years, and he's trying to. This is how long it took him to get it made.
Paul W. S. Anderson's a really interesting guy. Before we get into talking about this film, because he did some noteworthy films, some good films, and some terrible films. Mm-hmm. He did the original Mortal Kombat,
which
is kind of. I mean, it's not a great film, but it is kind of a significant. Video game movie. Like, it really...
It's one of the few when people bring up video game movies that usually they bring up in a good way rather than, like, trashing on it.
I mean, it kind of captured sort of the feel of the game.
Oh, totally.
As well as, like, any film had. I mean...
It had an awesome soundtrack.
Yeah. The soundtrack, man. That probably was the most memorable thing about it.
And probably almost half the reason it's popular
now. Yeah, that's true. But, I mean, he also did Event Horizon, which is a fairly enjoyable film. Like, I mean, that's a solid movie. He did Soldier, the Kurt Russell one.
That's right, yes.
Which is an underrated film, I think. He did Resident Evil, the first one was good. He did a couple of the later ones too. Mm-hmm. The last two, I think. Which I mean, I believe he's
kind of.
Well, I think he's married to Mila Jovovich.
Ah, that's right.
And
yeah,
so
you
know,
right.
I can kind of understand.
It's like,
you know,
the underworld principle.
Yeah, you kind of want to spend time with your wife. I don't blame him for that. He did AVP, the first one. Which, I conceptually you understand why someone would want to do that.
Yeah.
And he did a Three Musketeers one, which...
Ooh, the recent-ish one?
Yeah.
Oof.
Which, I mean, you know, it's not a good idea.
Not good.
But in terms of this, like, it's a guy who's wrongfully sent to prison for killing his wife.
Yes.
And, you know, as part of, you know, the prison thing, you can drive these cars in a death race, and if you win several times, you get... released.
Yep.
And he's
fight for your life.
There's a lot of actual enjoyable things in the movie. Like the races themselves are kind of entertaining. His character is fairly sympathetic. Like, you enjoy his character. The big problem is, like, Joan Allen as the villain is so over the top. It's kind of more comedic than like anything else.
And I just wish it was much more in line with the original than the original was a Roger Corman classic, cheesy, over the top, silly. Had Sylvester Stallone driving a car with machine guns on, Tommy guns for headlights. I mean, come on.
Yeah, I mean, you have people like Ian McShane, a supporting role, who's entertaining.
Wasn't Danny Trejo in this also?
I don't remember him. Maybe. But you had others like Jason Clarke was in this. You have Tyrese, entertaining supporting character.
Yeah.
You had Natalie Martinez, who I think went on to do. End of Watch, actually.
Oh, yes,
very good in that.
That's right.
So, you know, it's not like a world-renowned sort of film, but it's you enjoy it. Like, it's sort of like
it has redeeming qualities.
The violence is kind of cheesy and over the top and entertaining, and sort of, you know, it's, I don't know what you want to call it, cathartic or whatever, where you feel like the bad people get what they deserve and stuff like that.
Yeah, you know, again, trying to keep in the, no, not just saying, being the downer who says he hates everything, but trying to look at redeeming qualities. One of the things that amazed me, I looked into this, you know, Jason Statham always pretty good shape. Mm-hmm. You know, he always seems pretty well fit, but you don't think about the fact that, like, even guys that look like in shape can get more crazy in shape and can get really, really nuts. And to get into shape for this film, Jason Statham trained for months with an ex-Navy SEAL.
Wow.
One of the key trainers who helped the Spartans in 300 get their build, right?
That would explain, yeah.
So that's one thing. Second part of that thing, he trained so hard for that role that he went from a 20% body fat to 6% body fat. Again, in 3 months. It took him 3 months to do that, which is pretty ridiculous
That's pretty obscene.
And then something I just find interesting, because, you know, he's doing all his own stunts a lot of times, doing his own fight scenes a lot of times. He's training hard to look this way. So I'm glad that with, like, the transporter where he wanted to change the thing because he thought it was not believable, that it's the similar vein. One of the things that Jason Statham had about this movie that, like, he was not going to do is he didn't want his character to fight in any martial art way that in any way mimic the transporter. He wanted to look very
different. Yeah,
he didn't want it to just be like transporter in a different venue. He wanted to, like, actually keep. And I can respect that.
Yeah,
regardless of my opinions of the film itself, I can respect somebody being like, hey, I want my action films to be genuinely action-y.
Now, do I think this film has justified them just releasing a third one direct to video? Like, I think, you know, we leave at one and we're good. Thankfully, he was wise enough not to return to this. Maybe he learned from Crank. I don't know. I guess he did Crank 2 probably after this.
Probably.
I mean, he was wise enough to make that decision, but it's
not great.
It got nominated for a whole bunch of stunt awards, World Stunt Awards.
Again.
every film of his, basically. But
I wonder if just, like, stunt groups out there, like, don't even care how bad the movie is. They're like, Jason Statham's in it, let's do it, because they know that they're, like, so renowned to be good stunts.
Probably. Continuing on the sort of action star path, I guess it made perfect sense that a few years later he did The Expendables.
Yes.
This is the Sylvester Stallone directed and put together project that brought together all sorts of action stars
classic action stars.
Yeah, some of them are even classic, you know, like Steve Austin.
Yeah, okay. How about notable action?
Notable action people, yeah.
I think it's interesting that this was... I don't know if this would be the reason why Jason Statham was picked, but I do think it's interesting this is the third movie Jason Statham was in with Jet Li.
Hmm.
So I wonder if the Jet Li connection maybe brought Statham along, or they were looking at Jet Li in more recent movies like War and The One, which are the other
or
two movies.
Or you could flip it around, and Jason Statham brought Jet Li in.
That, yeah.
I mean...
Like, they brought Jason Statham in, and he was like, why isn't Jet Li here? And they were like, oh, that's a good point. Why isn't Jet Li here?
I'll make a call.
I don't know. The one reason I might argue it being the latter is because Jason Statham plays, like, the best friend character.
It's true.
Which, I mean, in both films, he's essentially the best friend. And Jet Li is there, and he's badass.
Yeah, that's true.
But it's not really, like, nearly as close of a connection.
I would probably agree.
Only reason why I feel like there's something that Stallone saw in Jason Statham that made him want to bring him in.
Maybe it was that he was in Death Race.
Maybe they met. Maybe he went to talk to him about the original or something like that. I don't know.
I think it's very important to note that this is probably, in my opinion, one of the most overly egregiously hyped franchises that exists, pretty much. Because of this, for this reason alone. There was plans for a sequel for this film 7 months before the first one came out in theaters.
Yeah, I mean, I hear you.
And that, with the combination of people being interested in it because of who's cast, not because of the story, not because of, you know, what they were going to do with it, but like, oh my God, those people are cast, clearly it's going to be amazing. And so many people have tried to talk me into how this movie is good because it simply has that cast.
No, I hear you.
But I disagree completely.
I hear you. There is an element of that. I think that there is sort of like a wish fulfillment sort of side of things where people got something that they'd wanted since like the 80s.
Yeah, nostalgia. It's a nostalgia circle jerk.
I'll go the other way, and I'll say I feel like people, when they actually saw the film, were kind of unfairly hating upon it. Like, I don't think it's a great film, but I don't think it's like people like absolutely just shit on this film. Like
me.
Like it's an okay film. It's not anything worthwhile. Like it's a generic action film. Like, and if you didn't look at it from under the guise of like, oh, all these famous action stars on it, it'd just be like, you know, just a generic action film.
Either way, I still have torturous to watch this movie.
I don't think it's torturous. I think it's fine. I think the sequel is actually a bit of a more of a letdown because, you know, you're expecting them like, oh, you're gonna get Arnold Schwarzenegger and Bruce Willis and blah 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 in this one. You're like, okay, cool. And they really only pop up at the end. Yeah. And did you see the sequel?
Oh no. Okay. I was talking about in the first one.
But like, it's essentially much more of, you know, like Terry Crews, Randy Couture. Jet Li has a very small part in it, and then he pops out. It's sort of like, so it's more of like the B list Expendables than the A list ones. Yeah. And you know, that's the A list ones are the ones you want to see the film for. Like that's the drawing point, as you said.
Exactly.
And so if you're not even bringing that, then it's sort of like, what's the point of this movie? Yeah. That being said, I think the film is fine. Like I don't think it's great, as I said, but I think it's entertaining enough for disposable popcorn movie. Like I think it's
this fine. This is one of those films that it not just maybe the cast helped this aspect for me, but I actually, and this happens with me with a lot of Jason Statham stuff. I find myself unable to enjoy the action because of how ridiculously stupid some of the things that happen are. Like I know it's a nitpicking point, but I will forever hate the moment in The Expendables where Dolph Lundgren, from a sniper advantage point, blows someone in half with a shotgun. A shotgun is not a sniper rifle. There's just so many elements of that movie that just get me, and they're just...
Well, that's Stallone's new thing ever since Rambo. Like, he's really been to the whole hyper-violent thing. Like, the last
thing Rambo... And you know what? The hyper-violence didn't work for him. Like, Rambo wasn't successful probably because it was overly violent.
It was successful.
Well, it wasn't as successful as, say, like, I think this and, like, what was it? I think The Dark Knight Rises and something else that were all PG-13. Dark Knight that were all PG-13 but were much more successful, even though they were very dark films. But
I mean, it's just successful enough that they're working on another Rambo. Like, I mean, I would argue that that's probably a better film than this one. But, you know, that being said, I mean, this is essentially, you know, like, just a rescue action film. And that's not necessarily, like, I agree that there's some stuff that's like cheesy and over the top just to be more badass or whatever.
Just to try to
like,
show how awesome they all are.
But like, you know, I mean, there's some entertaining stuff. Like there's something funny about seeing Dolph Lundgren fight Jet Li. Like I think there is some charm to the relationship these people have. Like Stallone and Statham do have some engaging back and forth.
It's not enough for me. I'm sorry.
Yeah, well,
I'm sorry.
Just a hard one to please.
So, I guess I am.
Yeah. All right. Moving right along. Sort of in a funny sort of path.
Weird twist.
Yeah. The Mechanic.
Yes.
Which is a story of a guy who kills the father of a young man, then essentially trains him to be an assassin under the guise of assassinating the man who killed his father, not knowing he's actually Jason Statham.
Yes.
Young man's played by Ben Foster, which, I mean, again, young man being a relative. He's probably like...
3 years younger than Statham. Yeah, probably, or something.
Probably 10. I'd say 10. But, you know, it's essentially, he's teaching him to be an assassin. It's sort of like The Professional if Jean Reno actually killed her parents.
Yes.
So,
if you think about it. And if, you know, Ben Foster was Natalie Portman's character.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I like Ben Foster. Like, I think he's a pretty talented actor.
I agree.
He's pretty solid. I mean,
I like him more than Statham.
Ooh. You know, the thing about this movie, I believe it's a remake.
Yes, it is. A Charles Bronson film.
Okay.
The original.
The thing about this film that sort of is the problem is that, you know, there's something about this poetry of training a kid to kill his father's assassin and then ultimately sort of turning him into a villain and then making the original assassin a hero somehow. This sort of kind of undoes like all the sort of morality it starts out by teaching.
Exactly.
Which
kind of makes sense if you think about it being a Charles Bronson film. Charles Bronson films were not huge on clear morality.
Well, the reason I sort of say it's sort of a twisty little path is because Statham goes from Expendables to this movie. This movie's directed by Simon West, who did Con Air, The General's Daughter, Tomb Raider, and they both go back to Expendables 2, which Simon West then took over directing. You know, I mean, I think the sort of the professional sort of storyline mm-hmm. is a good one. I like the young assassin learning to be an assassin.
Assassins as protagonists are always interesting mm-hmm. to me.
I mean, there's a sort of interesting morality mm-hmm. to them. But, you know, yeah, ultimately, it's sort of like an unfulfilling turn to the story. Yeah, it's just like, I feel like you gotta kill a character like Statham after sort of setting him up.
Yeah.
You know, it's sort of like that scene in Kill Bill 1 mm-hmm. where she kills Vivica Fox in the first scene. And yes. sort of like, you know, if you have to come back mm-hmm. and kill me later,
yeah.
like, I get it, you know, exactly. that's what you gotta do. And it's sort of like, it feels like there's sort of this cyclical nature to mm-hmm. it
that should be fulfilled yeah, in some sense.
But it isn't. And
what a shock.
Yeah.
They don't kill Statham because he's the main character.
But, you know, Ben Foster's made to be, you know, a pretty tough, yeah. badass character and likable as well. Mm-hmm. And sort of to pull that rug out from under yes. him kind of ruins the movie. I mean,
this film, I guess, like, it had its trailer pulled in Britain. Like, the BBC pulled it because it was, I think it was, and it was also, like, played during Glee and got, like,
wow.
a crap ton of requests to take it down and complaints huh. because it was a pretty graphic, violent trailer, I guess, and the original trailer showed, like, a dude's head being blown up, and then, like, serious, like, violence and stuff, and having, I guess, the Glee audience was not prepared for that.
All right. So. I could see that being a problem, yeah. No problem
with yeah.
that. But, you know, I mean, it's not terrible. It's just the ending is unfulfilling. Yes. That's what my main yeah. problem is.
Go watch the Charles Bronson original. Charles Bronson's.
It's cool. Awesome or guy. Just watch Charles, or just watch Bronson. Deathwish.
Yeah, oh, yeah, or watch just Bronson yeah. with Tom Hardy.
Yeah, that's good.
That's a great film, too.
Brings us to this Friday, mm-hmm. the 25th of January. Parker is yes. coming out. This is from director Taylor Hackford, who did some interesting stuff. He did Dolores Claiborne, which mm-hmm. is a decent mm-hmm. Kathy Bates movie. He did The Devil's Advocate,
ooh.
Which seems to be a cult hit.
Favorite of mine.
He did Proof of Life, which was the self-destructing Russell Crowe, Meg Ryan film when her affair came to light.
Mm-hmm.
But he also did Ray, which did pretty well for yeah. itself, and Jamie Foxx,
yeah.
you know. He's done some decent stuff. It's based on the Richard Stark novels.
Hmm. Interesting.
It's a graphic novel series.
Okay.
And it's about a thief with a unique code of professional ethics. Does that sound familiar?
Wow, he's almost like he's some kind of hitman-y badass.
Yeah, he's double-crossed by his crew. Maybe he's going to do some driving, too. Left in Left for Dead, assuming a new disguise and forming an unlikely alliance with a woman on the inside,
mm-hmm.
he looks to hijack the score of his crew's latest heist.
Mm-hmm. The woman on the inside played by?
J-Lo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, the film has a whole bunch of people I like in it, I gotta mm-hmm. be honest. You know, it's got, obviously, Statham and Lopez are fine.
Yeah.
But you got Michael Chiklis, Wendell Pierce from The Wire.
Mm, yeah.
You got Clifton Collins Jr., Bobby Cannavale, from a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah, he's been awesome.
I loved him on Third Watch, one of my favorite TV shows of all time. NBC, why don't you finish releasing that goddamn series on DVD?
I think he was also in the most recent season of Boardwalk Empire.
Yeah, he's done all sorts of good stuff. I mean, he was, he's just a great actor. Let's not even go down all the great things he's done. And it's got Nick Nolte as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
The Nolte.
Hopefully he'll redeem his role in Gangster Squad, which was essentially nothing. Like,
he was just there for supporting cast. He was there to be a name in the cast.
If you ask me, he brought himself back after mm-hmm. his role in Warrior, which
yes.
was phenomenal. Great, great underrated film. Bringing it back to Tom Hardy.
I kind of feel like Nick Nolte was tossed in Gangster Squad just because of Mulholland Falls.
Yeah, he might have been.
Like a nostalgia sense. Let's get an old actor that played in one of those
movies. He might have been, but like, I mean, he is, like, it had been so long before Warrior that he had done something interesting that when he did it, I was like, oh yeah, he actually was a good actor. Mm-hmm. And so for him to go back to like...
shot of his definitely killed it.
Yeah. To go back to like muddling around, like mm-hmm. it's kind of a bummer. And so I really hope big things for him. You know, in terms of J-Lo, like... she's not a great actress. No. Like, she's okay.
Yeah.
She's sort of like Jason Statham in the sense that she can do dramatic mm-hmm. well sometimes, and she can do comedic.
Comedy, yeah.
Like, she's talented.
But she doesn't make the best movie choices.
No, both of them don't. Yeah. And, you know, in terms of action, like, I mean, what are we going to really, like, advertise or based upon, like, Anaconda?
Or Out of Sight.
Yeah, I mean, it's like...
But those are both, like, what? Like, almost 10, 15 yeah. years old?
Like, she's really much more of a rom-com yeah. sort of one. And, I mean, I'm sure there's a love story going on.
I would be very surprised.
They have some sexy times, mm-hmm. it looks like, going on the trailer.
Yeah, and I bet he performed his own sex scenes.
Yeah. Way to go, Jason Statham.
Staying true to your form.
As always, as a disconcerting thing is, they're not screening this film for press until the day before its release. I think, ooh, if at that, it's like an 8 p.m. screening.
Ooh.
So they're really holding it back as humanly late as they possibly can.
That's not a good
without
sign.
Without not just not screening it.
That's
so,
not a good sign.
Yeah, it's never a good sign. But, you know, I'll check it out. You know, I don't know if there's anything really that good coming out that week. I guess Amore is coming out locally, so maybe that's something. But, you know, if you have nothing better, maybe Parker's something to check out.
Maybe
it'll surprise all of us and be entertaining. I don't know. He's done some decent stuff in his past.
Yeah.
I'll give him the benefit of the doubt.
I would like to see him return to some of those better things rather than going down what I consider the schlock fest of the last, like, 6 years or so.
Yeah.
But that's just me. I can respect the guy. I don't have to like his work, but I can respect him for at least, like, for a guy who's been, you know, either on purpose or on accident, somewhat pigeonholed as an action star, at least he stays relatively true to doing his own action.
Yeah, that's cool.
You know?
He's the new Jackie Chan, then, I guess?
I was going to go more Tom Cruise and Mission Impossible type thing.
Okay, I can respect that. So. Anyway, join us next week for our DVD picks for the week of January 29th. Rundown of January 29th.
Nomenclature correct.
The last Tuesday in January. We're already done with 1 month here. Yeah, believe it or not. Believe it or not, we're already done with January DVD rundown. As always, you can find us at MacGuffinPodcast.com, Twitter.com/MacGuffinCast, Facebook.com/MacGuffinPodcast, phone number 323-761-9842. We're on iTunes, we're on Roku, Miro, Blip.tv.
Check in and get glue. Get some stickers, badges, whatever it is you get.
Leave us some reviews on iTunes and whatnot, and we'll see you next time. T-1000 can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Magneto can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. It's tight. Don't even try to bite the side of style. Mr. Spock can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Borg can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Because I've got space game and it feels all right.